Good evening. First of all, let me thank for inviting me to this important forum, and also it's indeed a privilege to be here. In fact, Andreas made my life much easier. The thesis that he was talking about is, I think, when I was listening to it, it looked like he was going to talk about Sri Lankan economy. This is, if you want a case study for thesis, I think you should look at Sri Lanka. So when you look at this presentation, you will agree with me. So let me first start just basic, I'll take only, I think, 10, maximum 12, 13 minutes. In Sri Lanka, for people who wouldn't have a good understanding or knowledge, this is just historically, Sri Lanka is one of the countries open up and liberalized economy earliest in the region in 1977. Since then, you can see the growth as an open economy. Growth has been relatively higher compared to those days, and on average about 4.5 kind of growth until 2013 onwards. And then obviously, we had 13 onwards. I can relate this story to this fiscal populism, and came down, and last year we had worst economic crisis in the history, economic contract by 8%, and now obviously stabilizing this year is going to be -3%, and hopefully next year gradually we will come back to a positive growth, hopefully under this macroeconomic program. And also look at the related crisis impact on the inflation. We have seen in the past, if you look at the first 1977 to first 30 years of the liberalization, still we had relatively high inflation compared to South Asian countries, average 12% inflation from 1970s, late 70s to 2000s is relatively high. This is also, I can relate that to fiscal dominance in monetary policy. I can show you the, how it's very volatile, average high inflation, two peaks, but all of a sudden, after about 10 years of low inflation, about from 2008 onwards, still all of a sudden shot up to 70% 12 months ago, and we brought it down to 1.3% within 12 months. So that is, again, a required process. So what is the background of this? Why there has been this kind of volatile inflation growth? The story is obviously, you can see the is a very proven twin deficit hypothesis that anyone can prove. That is a lot of empirical evidence you can see here. The fiscal deficits, budget deficits, are very closely correlation with the external current fund deficit. This is what we call the twin deficit story. Then Sri Lanka is a classic example of twin deficit hypothesis. And just a little bit more, and how that has come about in terms of fiscal populism. You can see the Sri Lanka's revenue as a percent of GDP. The red bar is 8.9% compared to all of other countries. Lowest is then Iran, and then this corner there, so can't see the countries. So basically, it's very, very relatively low compared to a lot of other, previous and emerging market countries. And how that comes in, this is a fiscal expenditure side. This revenue versus expenditure, you see high deficits. And obviously, early 1980s, you can see very high public expenditure that is basically related to high inflation, also some peaks. But that was mainly coming from soon after economy was opened in 1977, and country that was liberalized early those days, where Sri Lanka was able to attract a lot of concessional financing and grants and very concessional loans. As they are a big public investment drive, you can see public investment are very high compared to recurrent expenditure. And that basically, we had some high growth as well as the high fiscal deficit, but still, because of very concessional loans and grants, we didn't have a debt issue those days. But later, this turned around to in a different story. And you can see late now, recurrent expenditure is high, public investment is low. As a result, growth has also been much lower than the historical averages. And the other story, with the very high fiscal expansion, funded by through monetary financing mainly longer period, and as a result the economy mainly became at some point export oriented economy became much more domestic oriented economy, and fiscal expenditure more towards the domestic kind of a construction, all these projects, and that did not generate sufficient foreign income. And also as a result of fiscal dominance and overvalued exchange rates with very high inflation, obviously that is a recipe for this kind of inward oriented economy that cannot be sustained for a long period. And also when you look at this large current account deficits on the red lines, how that has been financed is you can see late from 2007 onwards is mainly debt financing, borrowing, especially by the governments, because Sri Lanka has been a capital account, basically restricted economy, and there are no private sector external borrowings, is very little, but government had to bring in external borrowings in terms of both concessional and also lately commercial. You can see this kind of external financing from the external borrowings is basically, and towards the during the crisis you can see all there's no access to markets, 100% deficit financed by domestic financing through monetary fiscal dominance, monetary financing. That's what we ended up at 70% inflation in 2022. So and the other story on the debt part, this is another important feature in Sri Lanka's government external borrowings. As I said earlier, until 2007, although government has been borrowing externally, it has been largely a concessional basis, so there's no debt burden, debt sustainability was okay, very low interest rates. And first, Sri Lankan government went to the market in 2007, accessed capital markets, and from that point onwards, once government was able to raise, because a lot of easy money with the easy monetary policy globally, low interest rates, it was kind of addicted to commercial financing, and as a sharply share of commercial financing, the market financing increased in a very short period over 50%. And then this is where the other issue is that the service payments became a big burden when you have a large amount of large deficits, large financing, and mainly over 50% through commercial sources. That's another thing. And then obviously related to that, the sustainability, we have never had primary surpluses only very few years. If you look at only 2017-18, under the IMF program, we had only 2 years of primary surplus, very small primary surplus, but all the years it has been a primary deficit, sometimes very large primary deficits. And this is one of the reasons I think you can see when you have this kind of macroeconomic instability mainly coming from fiscal populism, and this is where Sri Lanka is one of the countries. We have had 16 bailout packages from the IMF, and this is, we are on the 17th one. I think closer competitor in our region is only Pakistan, I think maybe 16, 17 times. I think this is where is what happens usually all the 16 times. Government commits to all the time. I can remember I was also involved as a central banker, carry central banker in negotiations. Every IMF program was based on revenue-based fiscal consolidation. That is the theme of the program. And you start the program, take some bailout money because current account deficit is high, because fiscal deficit is high, then IMF come and bail out after 2, 3, 4, 5 tranches, and then elections coming up, then just say suspend the program and go back to the same kind of things, and then you have to repeat in cycles of back and forth. And that has resulted in, this is one of the issues, obviously fiscal populism, is that whenever there is a commitment and when there is a compulsion, then only governments tend to implement difficult fiscal reforms. But when it comes to elections, and because those are popular things and they always go back, and then ended up with another balance of payment crisis, basically sourced from the fiscal high fiscal imbalances, then again go back. And this is why the 17th time, this time In fact, one advantage we had last 16 times, we never had the sovereign debt crisis. All the earlier 16 times, this time came up debt crisis as well as balancing crisis together. So there's no, and bailout was not sufficient. Debt restructuring also needed. That's where this is the debt story. You can see when you look at all these stories, all the macro variables, how that has been moved. And this is where the latest public debt to GDP and also foreign currency, external government, external and domestic debt part. And the are important point, as I mentioned earlier, external part, larger part became more commercial and debt service payments relatively high. And even domestic part is because of the relatively high inflation, interest rates were high. And obviously last recent years with the high monetary financing by the central bank, then even though monetary finance had still revenue, debt service payments as a percent of revenue as last 3-4 years continuously, 65%, 70%, and even this year is going to be still 65%. So imagine common revenue, 70% goes for only debt service payments. Interest payments, not this, it's only interest payments in this kind of situation. This is where I can see how that twin deficit story basically creating two kind of a balance of payment crisis and also the debt crisis. This is where the balance of payment side of the story. When you look at here, the comparison is that the red line is the level of gross official reserves, and the blue green lines are foreign currency debt service payments. Until 2020, just the year hit by pandemic, the reserve levels are only sufficient to 1 year debt service payments. But unfortunately, because of this, again, 2019 was an election year. And soon after the new government came into power, there was a huge reduction in taxes were cut down as promised by the government in the previous election. Because 17, 18, 19, there was an IMF program where those are the years government generated 2 years of primary surplus under the program. And obviously this was not so popular because taxes had to be raised. Then the next government used that opportunity saying that, okay, this IMF program is no use. You have to pay more taxes. When you come back, we'll cut taxes. Then soon, even before the pandemic, end of 2019, they cut hugely. There was a huge tax reduction. And then the pandemic hit, and this was only sufficient to 1 year of debt service payments, about $6 billion, close to that. And as a result of these tax cuts and the pandemic impact, and Sri Lanka had market taxes until then, that's how we have been rolling over. But with that, there's no market taxes. And from 2020 onwards, all the deficit, higher deficits due to the pandemic and other reasons, had to finance through 100% domestic markets. Early it has been 50-50 from commercial markets, commercial, external commercial markets, but ultimately, unfortunately, 2020, 2021, this kind of high deficit financed through 100% domestic and largely central bank financing. Then you can imagine 2022, 70% inflation was already coming in when this was happening. That was obviously 21. And also, a subprime crisis is that because there's no market access, there's a rating downgrades. Obviously, when you see this kind of situation, rating agencies, no market access, basically, then it was a recipe for a crisis. Both the government ability to meet the service payments in 2022 April is where I was asked to come and take over the position of governor. Now look at the reserves, the usable reserves. The central bank, we had only $25 million, while we had to pay $6 billion in next 12 months at the service payments. So this was the situation. Unfortunately, Sri Lanka's amicable record of, although these challenges were there, Sri Lanka never ever defaulted and all the external or domestic services to the dot on the same date. But this was a historical situation in 2020 April. I took the position 8th of April, and we had to announce debt service suspension on 12th of April because we didn't have any usable resource. Only $25 million and 200 million within 4-5 days to be settled. No one was willing to give any money because of the rating downgrades. And looking at the situation, so basically we had to, that was a turning point. Basically, first in my office, what I had to do was to raise interest rates first by 700 basis points, 7%, 14%. That was 8th of April. 12th of April, we had to announce the suspension of external debt service with an intention to restructure and ask for more time from the creditors. Please give us some more time. We will make it good. Once we structured, that was kind of a, we didn't have any option. Without being hard default, it was kind of a situation. Then obviously, negotiate program with the IMF soon after. But in meantime, already country was going through a crisis, social unrest. There are shortages of essential petroleum, gas, everything. And people on the in the streets, there were several times finance ministers were changed. President had to go, presidents were changed, prime ministers were changed, cabinets were changed. Ultimately, from July onwards, there was a relatively stable government. And the central bank took strong measures. We were able to recover gradually. And we are now in with the IMF program, debt restructuring going on. So hopefully we can come back. But still, here's the story, what happened. Basically, this for everyone to understand the fiscal populism. And now the 17th IMF program coming with the sovereign debt crisis, as well as balance sheet crisis, I think with the debt restructuring, this is hopefully the last time that we would be doing that. This is what I said earlier, illustration of when 2022, when resources are coming down, next several years, debt service payments over $6 billion every year, commercial debt including for 5 years, when we had only about less than $1 billion or usable resources, $25 million. That's where we had to announce the suspension. And this is how we are in the process of now this debt service payments in the future. And we need to first restore the sustainability after restructuring both external and domestic debt. We have already completed domestic debt restructuring. In the process of completing external debt restructuring, so that government will get at least almost 10 years of liquidity relief, so that we have time and buffers and space to recover the economy going forward. That is the going forward. And basically, on that basis, this is the last slide. Now, with the crisis actually gave us opportunity to implement all the difficult reforms, and also largely population. I now have a better understanding of populist fiscal policies. And as a result, so far since July, April last year, within this year, 1 year and 6 months period less than, we have been able to implement, these are the five pillars of the this time, our commitment with the IMF. You can see always, like in the past, primarily objective revenue-based fiscal consolidation and plus structural reforms. And I part that I didn't talk about energy pricing, a lot of subsidies, all the state-owned enterprises owned by government were making losses with subsidized prices. And then as a result, the poverty increased from 12% to 25% within 1 year with the crisis. That's where the social safety net is important, that this program, and then the restored sustainability. We are in the process of restoring the sustainability. And the other important one, it's a monetary policy, central bank independence, and addressing fiscal dominance and rebuild external resources. A third pillar, that is very important reform. The lessons we learn from the fiscal dominance is that now we have a new central banking act. Last month it was effective. Within a very short period it was brought in. And where the issue we had in the earlier law, there was a provision in the central banking legislation that there's a provision central bank can directly finance in a weekly treasury bill auction. If there's no subscription, central bank would be able to finance. And also, in terms of that provision was completely removed in the new act. And secondly, the central bank board, secretary of the Minister of Finance, was an ex officio member. He was out of the central bank board now. And thirdly, the monetary policy framework. If you can remember inflation, there was a 10-12 years of 5% inflation. That was central bank implemented informally flexible inflation targeting regime. It was successful. for a long period. But all of a sudden, after the pandemic and also following the pandemic, the my predecessors believed what we call, the modern monetary theory. That's where 2020-2021 was a huge monetary expansion, central bank finance, the large part of fiscal, huge fiscal deficits, and end up inflation. Now, in the new law, while excluding the central government representative in the Monetary Central Bank Board, and also the prohibition of monetary finance indirectly, and then the third part, inflation targeting regime, is now part of the law now in the central bank, new central banking law, as well as much more modern macroprudential, also central bank is financial stability, that's where safeguard financial stability. A lot of reforms going on the Banking Act, financial stability, macroprudential area, that's already part of the done. And the latest pillar of this on Sri Lanka program, latest pillar of the IMF is reduced corruption vulnerabilities and growth enhancement. Corruption vulnerabilities is one of the issues that we had in the past. I think that's why Sri Lanka is the first country in Asia that we had corruption diagnostic study by the IMF Independent and World Bank, and this was published last month. And on that basis, there are a lot of measures that in the next 4 years that implement a lot of reforms to address that important part as well. So this is where we are. Hopefully, as Andrew Sol mentioned, I hope next 30 years there won't be, like if you can see the chart that we show the Chile, probably the idea, but you never know, this fiscal populism is something, it's very challenging. Once you get into this kind of system, people are expectations, and you know, without changing people's perception, mindset, and understanding, there is a risk of going back, but hopefully this time, whole population with the crisis have understood it better than hope they still work. Thank you.